Welcome back. I'm Shilpa and you are watching CIET and CERT live session on Swayam Prabha Kishore Manch. Today we will talk on educational e-content, concept and forms. Just to give you a rough idea, e-learning is a process and e-content is a product. This approach of teaching has become an answer to the complicated modern social, economical condition and an exploding population. We will know how. To talk more on this topic, we have Professor Indu Kumar, Head DICT and Training Division at CIET and CERT. I welcome you, Professor Indu.
Namaste. Hello, Shilpa.
But before we proceed, I would like to inform viewers, if you come across any questions or any suggestions related to our today's topic of discussion, then do not forget to call on our toll-free numbers. Numbers are 1-800-111-265 and 1-800-111-2199. You can also send your questions on our official email ID, ciet.kishoremanch@gmail.com. Moreover, you can comment your question during our YouTube live streaming, which is happening now, and our official YouTube channel is NCERT Official. Professor Indu, please do tell us what you will be telling us today, and now over to you.
Yeah, we will be discussing about educational e-contents and what are the different forms of educational e-contents. The topic is very relevant during this lockdown period because all the teachers are teaching or are in touch with their children from home. So, in the given circumstances, a lot of e-content they need to, educational e-content they need to be shared with the students through digital medium, through various mediums. So, it will be very important for us to know what are educational content, to what we call educational e-content, and how they can be integrated with the teaching learning process. They are relevant in regular day-to-day teaching also, but when we are sharing content, we are into a flipped mode of learning, where we are sharing e-content with the students and then we are in touch with them through synchronous communication, then we can discuss about what we share. So, whatever content which are relevant to a particular topic that we are teaching and adds value to it, to the understanding of a particular concept, is called e-content. And we share all those e-content through electronic or digital media. So, any e-text, digital text, audio, video, voice narration, music, interactive content and other form of content like images, graphics, singly or in combination, which help us create a piece of communication to understand a topic better, are called digital content. So, this is the you can say definition of e-content or digital content. Generally, we use these two terms synonymously. There may be a minor difference, but we need not to go into the integrity of the definition. But how those which are available in the form of audio, video, music, images, interactive content, and how they can be utilized, what are the different forms, is more important for us to know. So, let us now understand what are the different forms of e-content. So, you can see here on the slide different forms of e-content, and you can see the list: mind maps, maps, simulations, audio, video, advertisements, interactive media, infographics, photographs, animation, cartoon, slideshows, timelines, diagrams, flow diagrams, charts, graphs. So, these are some of the forms of e-content. All these types of, not all, but many of these contents are also available with the textbooks, in the print textbooks. But when we tend to add value to to whatever is available in the textbooks, because it is a very general understanding of every teacher or anyone who is using the textbooks. There is a lot between the line. There are things which are written in the textbooks, and there are many things which are in between the lines, which make us understand the concept better. So, to fill that gap, to understand what is there between the lines, sometimes we need to explain a concept better, but wherever there are some abstract content which are difficult to conceptualize, we need to add some kind of some more content. When digital technology was not so advanced and we were learning how to teach children, so we were using teaching aids. So, those teaching aids were helping us explain a concept better, to make it more concrete. But now, with the advancement of digital technology, we can have more forms of digital contents, like we can also have animations, we can have interactive contents, we can have audios, we can have videos, which are a lot more than what we were using earlier as teaching aids. So, all these things help teacher to explain the concept better, and in this lockdown situation, when we are sharing content from home, so whatever topic we are teaching and wherever we feel that there is a gap, there are something abstract, there are something which is in between the line and need to be explained, we can share e-content related to that with our children. They can watch it, understand it, have some questions, and when teacher is in touch with them through video call or through any other synchronous mode, they can raise their queries and questions. So, that is how in a limited time we can capitalize on learning by using digital content. So, I will be demonstrating actually different some of the forms which are listed in the list, so that teacher may better understand what are the examples of what I have listed in the previous slide. So, I also listed mind map. So, let us see what a mind map is. So, here you can see a mind map. Let me so, this mind map is based on microbes, and it unfolds the learning about this concept in a very beautiful way. So, mind maps can be used to plan teaching, to actually unfold whatever sub concepts related to a particular concepts. So, we can actually create a mind map based on the complete picture of a particular concept, and further explain the concept and sub concept and sub sub concepts related to a particular concept. So, now I am going to show you an example of flow diagram. So, so you can see here, this flow diagram is based on the topic taxonomic categories showing hierarchical arrangements. So, you can see here the picture of a tiger, the photograph of a tiger, which kingdom a tiger belongs to. You can see here the hierarchical representation of that: kingdom, phylum, class, order, which family a tiger belongs to, which genus a tiger belongs to, and which species a tiger belongs to. So, using this flow diagram, we can explain this taxonomic categorization. So that is a flow diagram, and we can have flow diagrams in different subjects, be it science, social science, maths, or any subject, commerce. So we can create and use flow diagrams to explain any concept better and have a pictorial representation of a particular thing. So there are timelines also. There are concepts which need to be chronologically explained. So timelines are used to explain a particular concept in a chronological order. Whenever we talk about chronology, we relate it to history. But chronology is not always related to history. There can be chronologies in science also, chronologies in different subjects also. So whenever we are trying to explain a particular development, a particular course of event, so we use timeline. So let me show you an example of timeline. It is an interactive timeline. Yeah, so you can see here the timeline, how the development of transportation took place over centuries. So you can see here, first humans used horses for transportation to go from one place to other place. So the time period is already written there on the timeline. And after that, when wheel was invented, so wheel was one of the earliest inventions which took place, and we don't know who was that human being who invented wheel, in whose mind the idea of wheel emerged. So the wheel was invented, and here we can see sailboats. After that, sailboats came into being. Then you can see camels. In some parts of the world, camels were used for transportation. Then you can see here wooden ship for sea transportation. So you can see the picture of ship here, and in more information about it. Then we can see the tar streets in Baghdad. How were the tar streets like in Baghdad? Then you can see here networks of roads in Rome. With the transportation, roads also started to be built upon. So in the cities, we had pakka roads, and in the rural areas, the kaccha roads were there.
Right.
So this picture is of the network of roads in Rome. Then compass, the when the invention of compass and where the invention of compass took place, it is written China here in the timeline, because with the advancement in transport, we also need to know which direction we are heading towards, and compass, especially in sea transportation, compass helped us in where we are going, in which direction we are going, because there are long stretches of water when we are traveling through sea. So compass help us decide upon to locate the direction. So here you can see the invention of rocket, the first mail, invention of first mail. So with the transportation, communication is also related. Earlier, when we were trying to send information from one place to other place, earlier people were moving with the message. But later on, the horse cart was started to be used for making such mails, sending mails. And now we have come up to the development when we are sending messages just by a click through emails. And here you can see the roads, And then hot air balloon, invention of hot air balloon is shown in the timeline. After that, the lifeboat, the use of lifeboat, when and where it is started. And here you can see the use of cycle, which is still in use. There are some form of transport which were used in ancient times also, in earlier times also, and which are still continuing. So, change is always with a kind of continuity also. We still use wood wheels in bullock carts,
right.
And there is tubeless tires also. So, that is how the continuity and change takes place, and with the help of timeline, we can explain so many concepts. So, here you can see steamship, then railways, the development of railways in India, omnibus, you can see here, and underground railways. When underground railways started, when in India an underground railway started, and the invention of car. Then first electronic underground train which ran in London. So, that is how with the use of timeline you can very well explain any development which took place over centuries. So, let me move on to the other form of content. I also mentioned in my list that cartoons are another form of digital content, because they also take us to a lot of learning. Cartoons are very interesting to see, and with some kind of humor, they make us curious to understand any particular event, any particular concept. So, here every day we see cartoons in newspaper, but here we are talking about, they are also educational, but here we are talking about the concepts which are there in the book. So, you can see here the about the dinosaur, all the other animals are watching at a notice which is hanged on a tree, and it is the picture of dinosaur is there on the notice, and it is written missing since a billion years. So, by using this cartoon, we can talk about extinction of the species from earth and other such concepts. So, cartoons are also very strong medium, and to understand it is about science, but to understand concepts related to political science, concepts related to history, day-to-day cartoons which are there in the newspaper. A teacher can discuss, she can take a photograph of the cartoon, share it with the students and talk with them the day-to-day phenomena, day-to-day events which are taking place in the society, in the country, in the world. So, that is how cartoons can be a very good learning resource, and here you can see simulation, example of simulation. So, this is simulation. So, we all know that amoeba is a single cell a mechanism, and here you can see with a single cell how digestion takes place in amoeba. So, through simulation, if we can watch and see the levels, we can understand the process of digestion which takes place in amoeba. So, let me move on to the next slide. So, here this is an image, it was a drawing, but it was the photograph was clicked out of this drawing, and it created into a form of an image. So, you can see here it is very it will be very interesting to teach elementary school children about the kitchen utensils, because we talk about so many things which are there in our surroundings, which we see, which we use. So, you can see kitchen utensils hidden in these pictures, And children can be asked to identify these utensils, name them, label them, list them, and how they are used in the kitchen. And we can also relate a lot of other concepts like cleanliness, how to clean the kitchen utensils, how to keep them in an organized manner, and what is used for what purpose when we work in the kitchen. So, this is another image. A lot of sports and play articles are hidden in this image, which you can very well see from the image. So, when we are talking about sports and games, and we can talk about the rules of the games, what are the rules to be followed while playing a particular sports or particular games, what are the articles or equipments we use while playing a game, who all won medals in the Commonwealth, in the Olympics games on particular sports and games. So, concepts like this, who are the women player which belong to our country or which belong to the world. So, we can also talk about concepts and things like that with a single by using a single image where a lot of sports and game articles are hidden. So, such content give them a kind of an experience of gamification also, because these images are gamified. So, they get interested in the images whenever we ask them to find something from a jumbled thing. So, children get interested. It is a kind of immersive experience for them. So, e-contents are very, very relevant for immersive learning also. We can immerse them in learning, and it is not a burden for them because they get immersed when gamification is added with some concept. So, here we can see photographs. I also listed photograph in the list of e-content which I talked about. So, it is a collection of photographs which I converted into a video for the convenience to show it. So, you can see here photographs of birds and some educational values added to it. Because we can talk about what is the name of bird, what is the scientific name of a particular bird, where the bird is found, which is the natural habitat of a particular bird, what or animal also, and what are the migratory habits, what is the natural habitat and what are the migratory habits of birds, why they migrate and in which season they migrate, where to where they migrate, when they come back, and why these migratory habits are there in birds. So, all such concepts we can discuss by using these photographs, doing some research, adding value to them and make them a meaningful digital content. So, next I am showing you an example of diagram. So, this diagram is based on how waterfalls are formed. So, it is a very complex phenomena, the creation of waterfalls. It takes place in centuries, but by using a single diagram, we can very well explain how waterfalls are formed. So, that is how we can say diagrams are very good way to explain a particular thing if it is digitized, available in digital form. We can explain complex phenomena using a simple one pager diagram. So, if I come back to the diagram, can we go back to it? So, you can see water flowing over hard rock and beneath it there is soft rock. So, whenever water flows over hard rock and it touches soft rock, the undercutting of the soft rock is faster. So, it erodes faster, and over a period of time there is a platform of hard rock. So, when water pressure is high on the hard rock, it gets broken. And we, if you have observed See a lot of broken stone under a waterfall. It
Right.
is because of the process by which a waterfall is created. So, a simple one-pager diagram, we can explain a phenomena which occurs in centuries. So, there are such diagrams in different subject areas. I have shown just one kind of diagram based on one particular concept, but there are a lot of concepts we can explain using diagrams. And in this lockdown situation, when we are not with children, we can share. They are very, very small. Their size is also very small. They are easy to share, doesn't use much space of your mobile. You can easily see them, use them, delete them, or you can keep them saved also, because they doesn't occupy much space of your memory
device.
Of your mobile. So, now I am going to show you an animation, and I hope the audio will be played. So, this animation is based on one of the earliest discovery. I am calling fire a discovery because it was not invented, it was already there.
कुछ चपटे कुछ थे नुकीले कुछ जैसे हो मोटी कीले कुछ कुदाल कुछ भाले जैसे कुछ मीठे चाकू से पत्थर से पत्थर को मार बना रहे थे वो हथियार टकराया पत्थर से पत्थर तब उससे निकली चिंगारी पास ही था पत्तों का ढेर आग सुलगते लगी न देर सीख लिया जब आग जलाना सर्दी का मौसम बना सुहाना उनकी गुफा हो गई रोशन खाने लगे पका कर खाना खाने लगे पका कर खाना खाने लगे पका कर खाना
आग
This was a stop motion animation. It's a kind of animation which is called stop motion animation, and it was about the discovery of fire, because we cannot say how earliest discoveries took place, because in prehistoric period we don't have any written records. We can just anticipate how a particular phenomena took place. So, this video beautifully explains, animation beautifully explain how the discovery of fire might have took place in the remote past. So, let us now see another form of e-content, which are interactive content, and in the interactive contents also there is an element of gamification. But for the convenience, I have created it into the form of an MP5 file, so that you can see a variety of interactive content. So, I am playing it now. So, first one is of maths.
Tol kar bol. Tarajoo par rakhe hue saman ko tolne ke liye उतने भार के बाट को तराजू के दूसरे पलड़े पर रखें
So children will learn adding as well as weighing. How do we weigh things?
Dubara prayas kare. Bahut acche.
So it's a drag and drop activity. So children will learn by trial and error also, and they can also learn by using their cognitive abilities, their mental abilities, by adding whatever numbers are written in the different ways, and then they can put it on the weighing machine. So that is how by gamification, by interacting with a particular content, they learn specific concepts. So let us move on to the other.
Arrange numbers on the ladder in ascending and descending order.
This is also a drag and drop activity.
Well done.
An instant feedback is also being given.
Well done. Well done. Oops, try again. Well done. Well done. Well done. Well done. Identify the occupation. Write the name of occupation in the blank space. Well done. देखें और पहचाने क्लू को पहचान कर सही विकल्प पर क्लिक करें दी घाटी के आसपास विकसित हुई यहाँ के लोगों ने लेखन रेशम के कपड़े ईंट मिट्टी और लकड़ी के भवन बनाने की शुरुआत की बहुत अच्छे चूचू करती आई चिड़िया जल्दी नाम बताओ भैया पक्षियों के सही नाम को पहचाने बहुत अच्छे
So here we have just seen interactive content in different subject areas. So by using such interactive content, we can also ensure the obtaining of learning outcome. If a particular interactive content is based on a particular learning outcome, like learning addition, mastering addition is a learning outcome. So the first interactive content which we watched of mathematics that leads to the ability to add, and likewise they can they are very good tool for assessment also with an element of games and interaction immersion with them. So, these were the example of interactive content. So now we have seen a lot of different forms of digital content, and now we can also understand, learn, the teachers may also understand when where and how we should use these e-content. So there is always a plan which teacher makes, whether a teacher is teaching face to face or a teacher is teaching through remote, like in this lockdown period, a teacher is in touch with his or her students via mobile, or we are teaching children using the television and all. So, the use of any digital content is pre-lesson, mid-lesson and post-lesson. So, before introducing to a particular concept, a teacher can share e-content related to that concepts. Children can watch that e-content, and later on teacher can engage them into discussion based on the content which she shared with them. There can be a mid-lesson. First teacher can introduce a particular concept, and in the mid-lesson she can share, she can use some digital content with the students, e-content with the students. Children watch and they consolidate which the concept which was already introduced by the teacher. And sometimes we use digital content for the consolidation of learning at the end of the lesson, like contents based on assessment. We can use post lesson. We introduce a particular lesson, and then the examples of interactive e-contents which I demonstrated here, they can be utilized for assessment, and that we can do post lesson. We can also do some assessment in the mid lesson also, but we can also have it post lesson. So, it is up to the teacher when she decides to introduce a particular e-content, whether she decides to introduce it pre-lesson, mid-lesson or post-lesson. So, there is also, you can see in this slide, criteria for selection any kind of e-content. It should be available. A teacher should know where the contents are available, their availability. And their suitability to pedagogy and content. They should be suitable to the pedagogy. They should not be just devoid of what we are teaching. Then it should be accessible also, whatever e-content which we are using. So, when we plan a lesson, so we by reading the chapter of the textbooks or concept we are going to teach, we very well understand. So, here is something abstract where I need to introduce a concept. Here is something on which I have to give something more to my children, but that e-content should be easily accessible. Only by deciding on that, that this particular content will be suitable, but that content should be available also, accessible also. It should not be copyrighted. If it is available, but if it is copyrighted, that means it is not accessible. A teacher should not use it because it has a copyright. So, accessibility issue is also very important. Then reliability and validity. The content which we have chosen to be introduced to our student, it should be reliable and valid. Sometimes content which we decide to use, it very fancy to look at, very beautiful to look at, but it leads to misconception. I came across a digital content where we needed to introduce to the concept of circle, which is two dimensional, but the e-content which was there in a particular device which was sold by particular vendor to a particular school was a sphere. So, that means that particular e-content is not reliable and valid because it is not teaching circle, it is a sphere. Right. Children may develop misconceptions if we use fancy, but errorful digital content. So, we have to look at the reliability and validity of a particular content which we decide to use. Then costing also is very, very important. Every teacher should not indulge with creating e-content. So, there are a lot of content which are already there, which are available. If those e-contents are not available and it need to be created, then teacher should invest time in creating particular e-content. Otherwise, first a teacher need to explore what is available. Then where to access e-content, this is my last slide, and we can go for some taking some questions after that. So to access digital content which will be reliable and valid, because they undergo a lot of evaluation process, we can access them from the repositories. There may be other repositories also, but these belong to NCERT, that is why I am mentioning these. NROER, National Repository of Open Educational Resources, e-Pathshala portal, and Deeksha portal and app. So you can see the URLs of these repositories. More than 70,000 digital contents, e-contents are available on Deeksha, and likewise a lot of e-contents are available on NROER. 17,000 are available on NROER, and there are a lot of content linked to textbooks which are available on Deeksha, and all the NCERT textbooks are available on e-Pathshala mobile app, and a lot of audio, video and other forms of content for the stakeholders like students, teachers, parents and educators are available there. Yesterday we already had a session on e-Pathshala, and we also had elaborate sessions on NROER and Deeksha which are available on YouTube. So this was my last slide. So Shilpa, now we can take if we have some questions.
Yes, we have received several questions, ma'am. Mm-hmm. The first question has been asked by Miss Rubika, and she is a teacher. Mm-hmm. She is asking, flip mode classroom, is it same as the introducing e-content to the classroom?
Flipped classroom is the kind of classroom when we flip certain activities to be done at home and spend classroom time in discussion. So whatever we spend time in teaching in conventional traditional classroom, we can share content related to that with the students using some digital mode. We can also use WhatsApp, we can also use Facebook groups, we can also use the social media tools which are there in the alternative academic calendar. You can see the annexure 1 of alternative academic calendar. They are given a lot of social media tools. So we can share whatever we plan to teach in the conventional classroom using those medium, and the classroom time when we are there with them face to face, that time we can devote to discussions. So that is flipped class. So it is a combination of interacting face to face with the students and sharing e-content. In the lockdown period, we share content and then we do asynchronous communication, synchronous communication with our children for discussion. So that is how flipped learning takes place.
Ma'am, another question has been asked by Mr. Sankaram Padi, and he is asking, mind map seems similar to concept diagram. Is it correct?
Yes, they are similar. But there are a minor difference in concept map and mind map. If we are planning something, we can use mind map. How my mind creates a picture of a particular concept, how I organize a particular concept as per the convenience of my understanding or my ease with delivering that content. So I can organize it in the way I want to deliver it, but in the concept length map there are interlinkages between main concept, sub concepts and sub concepts. So that in totality takes us through a particular concept, the concept map. But mind map is my own organization of a particular concept. It can be used to unfold teaching also. So we can use it as presentation also. to present something. Right. As a presentation tool also, we can use mind map.
Okay, ma'am. Another question has been asked by Ms. Dhuri and Mr. Vikram. They both are asking almost same questions.
Okay.
The parents nowadays are teachers for their children. So how they can use e-content and what kind of e-content at home?
Actually, we are not expecting parents in this situation to be teachers. We are expecting the role of parents to manage that they learn while they are sitting at home in the lockdown period. So, their role is to make a time schedule for them, support them with learning, and teachers are sharing learning resources with these students, but role of parent is to help them learn. So, they can also be engaged in the discussion, engage children with discussion. But there are a lot of children in our country whose parents are not literate, those who are first generation learner. So, those parents can also support their children in lending the one device that they are having with them. Among different children and do timetabling and support with them. And for that also they need to be oriented by the teachers.
Right. That will certainly help Ms. Dhuri and Mr. Vikram. Ma'am, next question has been asked by Mr. Vikramaditya and he is asking, do we have to use e-content according to the age and stage?
Yes, that is a very valid question. And e-content in NROER and Deeksha, they are organized label wise also. Because we have to keep in mind the level of students for choosing a particular e-content. We cannot introduce a very difficult content which is complex to a child which is studying in a primary class. But right. There are content which are suitable for 2-3 classes like this addition. If it is there in the syllabus in class 1, 2 and 3, so it is suitable for all the 3 classes. But the difficulty level we need to assess if we are randomly picking up an e-content from anywhere. So, that need to be assessed by the teacher before introducing it.
Ma'am, we are left with only 2 minutes. I'll take up one more question and then you can just give a message to the viewers. Another question has been asked by Mr. Rakesh and he is asking from where we can get that online simulation which you had showed us.
It is there on NROER. So, you can explore these repositories and there is a software which is not very difficult to master, H5P. So, most of the digital content, interactive e-contents which I demonstrated here are developed using that software and that timeline which I demonstrated is also developed using H5P. So, we can explore these repositories. These are all these content which I introduced here are developed by NCRT faculty and NCRT's technical teams. So, you explore our repositories and you will get all the digital contents there. And we are into topping it up every day. We are filling it up with more and more e-content which is being developed by our faculty and with the help of the technical team.
Right. So, today we very well understood what is e-content, which is also termed as electronic content that include text, image, graphics, animation, audio and video and how one can integrate for the educational purpose. Also with such integration, children can learn by their own doing, by with their own experience. And thank you so much, Professor Indu, for guiding us.
Thank you, Shilpa.
And in the next session, we will talk on handling feelings of hopelessness and anxiety during COVID-19. So, be with us. We will be back after a short while.